Welcome, everyone. My name is Vishal Kapoor, and I work at Dasra. We're a strategic philanthropy foundation based in India, raising support for development in India globally, and have most recently been focused on raising both rapid relief funding, but also longer-term resilience and rebuilding efforts in India through the COVID pandemic. I'd like to introduce my co-speaker, Neelam Chibbar, who's co-founder of Industry and a social entrepreneur who's really been at the cusp of providing much needed relief and resilience for some of the communities hardest hit during the pandemic. And I'm really excited to be in this conversation with her and to share it with all of you. So with that, welcome, Neelam.
Hi, Vishal. Great to be here and lovely to be having this conversation with you. Awesome. Yeah.
Super. So Neelam, you know, we all know that COVID's had a devastating impact on South Asia broadly, India specifically. And with so many people and groups affected, you know, what's your sense of how can we think about which groups perhaps are the most vulnerable, right? Or currently and thinking longer term, or which groups have really been the most affected?
Yeah, Vishal, I think this is a very great conversation we are having because I think it's really, really significant to highlight the kind of trauma that in South Asia, yeah, and my numbers will speak a lot about India, but I think the rest of South Asia is really seeing the panic now. We had it earlier on in the year where we saw that within the communities, 243 million people have lost work, right? We have seen the entire migration trauma where millions and millions and millions of people were displaced in the first wave last year. And in the second wave, we've seen that the loss of jobs, the loss of incomes has only been accentuated. And it's not just the loss of lives or the loss of the immediate impacts that have been caused by COVID. So like someone was telling me the other day, COVID is the earthquake. The tsunami is following. Yeah, the tsunami of so many people being pushed into poverty by the economies coming, all the growth economies, all their numbers are down. So, I mean, the aftermath is what we are all seeing today. And what we are seeing also is the impact on women. I would say the most vulnerable amongst, we of course have the migrants, we have the farm sector, the rural sector, but the women, according to data from the 243 million who have lost work during COVID, 10% of the men were back, were without job at the second wave. But 43% of the women never got back to work, right? And when we see this happening with our women across India, rural and everywhere, we are already seeing the impacts of hunger. We are seeing the impacts on education, nutrition, right? So, I mean, kids are out of school. We are seeing an increase in child labor at rural level. So these are all some of, I think, the most vulnerable communities that have been impacted. And this is not just about India. It's all across South Asia.
Absolutely. So it's almost like thinking about, you know, the demographic of women and maybe women and girls across all of these vulnerable groups, right, as being, you know, even more marginalized than other subsections of these groups. No, that makes a lot of sense. And just switching gears a little bit, I mean, you know, that's sort of on the side of the groups that have been affected. Now, you've got your finger on the pulse of, let's call it the response, right? How groups have stepped up to respond to this. And we're fortunate to have a strong civil sector, civil society in India. And so if you could, you know, give us some insights and your experiences through this, you know, through the stepping up that you've seen of NGOs in this time, you know, of urgent need, and especially the kind of partnerships or collaborations, if any, that you've seen come about.
Yeah, Vishal, I mean, it's been a crazy time for everyone, not just all over the world, in Asia and in India. What we have noticed that there's been a great coming together. Civil society in India was never really a very united sector, but a full marks to all of us across the impact space in India. Everyone has coalesced. We have almost 4 to 5 very strong coalitions that have arisen out of COVID. Industry itself has launched a coalition called COVID Livelihoods Coalition. But before that, after the first wave, there's COVID Action Collab, there is RCRC, and then now in COVID 2.0, when we saw what was happening with the fact that livelihoods is going to be so deeply impacted. So these coalitions have so far, all the other coalitions have been working on health, how to get the rural communities aware, how they should be masked up, how things should not spread. Because India's health system was, the rural health system primarily, was not really prepared for COVID. Yeah, in urban India, because of, I think, the oxygen issues, but otherwise, urban India was reasonably well prepared, apart from that entire oxygen fiasco that happened. But in India, healthcare in rural India is not really what it should be. And therefore, a lot of coalitions came up to create more awareness around health, around vaccination hesitancy, and things like that. But we realized that the big tsunami, which is the livelihoods, which is the income generation, right? So many families are cast into debt over their medical expenses. And so many of the primary breadwinners are no longer there. Young children are orphaned. I mean, the amount of trauma is so great that it's just quite clear that livelihoods is something which really needs focus on. As it is, economic transformation of women in India was not at a very high pace. India's women's participation in the labor force pre-COVID was somewhere in the lowest numbers in the world. Our women's labor force participation is the same as Pakistan's, by the way, right? We are at some 226, a very, very dismal number on the global index. And then we have COVID that hits us, right? So we did COVID Livelihoods Coalition, which today has about 84 organizations as members. And we have a very key focus on value addition, because there's a lot of scientific thought and analysis that the poor are going to be pushed so much deeper into poverty that tracking or working on the situation as we used to in the past will no longer be sufficient, right? So we really cannot have say that farmers need to improve efficiency in farming or artisans need to just improve their situation. We have to look at increased value addition, right? And there industry comes with its technical know-how on having women artisans fall into global supply chains like IKEA, where the value addition is phenomenal, where, you know, incomes triple. So the reason that CoLive has been able to be launched, we've co-convened it, we are champions of CoLive, but it's co-convened by 84 organizations and it reaches 25 million households. So the very fact that we've been able to get some of the largest civil society players in the country with us, Seva, World Vision, and really, really large players, is because everyone is now saying that we really need to get into value addition. How are we going to transform incomes of the poor to pull them out of the poverty that they will be pushed into by COVID?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, it's been, even from Dasra's vantage point, has just been amazing and, you know, truly inspiring to see the level of collaboration, coalition formation that's happening, you know, amongst social entrepreneurs, nonprofit leaders like yourself, which also sort of begs the question, where are the funders, right, in all of this? And these coalitions that you spoke about, is there active participation from the funding community? Is it largely nonprofits? I'd love to hear a little bit more about that too.
So, well, I'll be very frank. When I say the community coalesced, I think the ecosystem also stepped up. And there, Vishal, I don't have to tell you, Dasra has played such a phenomenal role, right? From almost the first week of the real crisis that COVID 2.0 caused, I mean, we've had Deval at Dasra just not sleeping, working, all your teams. And I mean, you've raised such phenomenal resources. And I mean, obviously, you'll share more about that. And I really want you to share your entire experience with that. But other than that, we have seen that there have been lots of donors in the ecosystem who have allowed for funding to be moved sideways, to be used effectively. Azim Premji Philanthropic Initiative, APPI, Azim Premji Foundation, really stepped up, right? So there's but I'd really love for you to share more about your experience and how did Dasra manage to do what they did in that period?
Yeah, sure. No, thanks. Thanks, Neelam. And, you know, thanks for mentioning. I'll talk a little bit about what, you know, we've done and also what we're seeing on the funder side. And so, you know, we launched in late April as the second wave really started devastating health systems, right, in Mumbai, New Delhi, Bangalore, and then, you know, rural India. We started responding, you know, Dasra as a, you know, as a bridge organization between the world of philanthropy globally, as well as, you know, nonprofit organizations and leaders like yourself. We actually started small. We weren't sure how big this was going to become. We set a target of saying, let's raise $500,000 and you know, get this out the door as soon as possible to as many organizations as we can. And with this huge outpouring of support that we saw, especially from the US and UK philanthropic community wanting to support what's happening in India, and of course, to some extent, India as well, but overwhelmingly from overseas, we realized that we could up the targets, right? So we went from $500,000 target in April to actually $5 million in May, upwards to $10 million in June. So in June, we were like, okay, we've sort of stabilized. We think we can raise, there's enough interest here to raise $10 million in pool funding, flexible funding for general operating costs for nonprofits to use towards COVID relief, but as they wanted, right? If they needed to hire more people, if they needed to spend internally to pivot towards COVID relief, which a lot of organizations became experts in overnight, but weren't actually set up to do. And you need to support that, right? So we said that, okay, let's actually, you know, raise this kind of flexible funding. A little bit on where we are. So we did, you know, we've been fortunate enough to meet that 10 million target that we set for ourselves. We've actually raised a little over 10 million from over 1,000 funders globally. And we've disbursed already 50% of that to across 80 nonprofits. And I think what's important and what we think really differentiates this and what's really the need of the hour is to spread this across a large number of organizations across the country, right, as fast as possible with agility. And so we've set a target of disbursing this to anywhere between 120 to 150 nonprofit organizations and have so far channeled support to over 80. Now, you know, we've made these grants, as you've probably seen, Neelam, with other grant makers that, you know, you've been a recipient of as well, with much greater agility, with a lot less sort of bureaucratic processes, right? And you know, like typical diligence systems, typical systems of receiving grant proposals. this has been really agile. It's been trust-based. It's been picking up the phone and speaking to organizations and leaders, getting short brief notes on what they're doing, and then getting the funding out the door, lowering the threshold on sort of the reporting requirements, getting a lot more mixed media around what's happening on the ground, right? So video reports on phones rather than long, lengthy reports. And of course, listening, right, to organizations and leaders about where do they need to spend what kind of funding, and trusting that they know what's best on the ground where they are, rather than us sitting in our homes right now in, you know, the cities and sort of dictating where funding should go. So that's what we've done. And you know, just then broadly what we're seeing, because all of this funding that I just mentioned, we've actually gone out there and raised it. It's, we're not endowed with funds that we're giving. So we've raised it from individuals, families in the US, in the UK, in India, as well as foundations, you know, family foundations, corporate foundations, et cetera. And so, like I said, we've seen this huge outpouring of support from the US and UK philanthropic community. Initially last year, it was really humanitarian relief. And you mentioned migrants, right, Neelam? And, you know, a lot of humanitarian relief, care packages, food rations for those hundreds of millions displaced migrant workers, right, who are walking back. This year, of course, it's taken a much more of a health angle. So funding for oxygen, funding for other health related sort of initiatives, testing, now, of course, you know, battling, you know, vaccine, you know, resistance and behavior change communication in rural areas. But I really think we need to use this opportunity to build on a couple of things, right? One is a lot of funders have stepped in to give, and this is like the first time that they're giving, and they just felt so pulled by this, you know, massive issue, this storm that we're all in, although we're in different boats, right, navigating the storm. But that has meant a lot of new people, a lot of new philanthropists have come into the fold, and a lot of existing legacy players are doing their philanthropy differently. But it can't stop here, right? This can't be a blip in people's philanthropic journeys. I think we need to double down here. We need to focus on the fundamental issue areas like livelihoods that you mentioned, Neelam, and keep that communication, keep that interest level with donors and that journey going on, so that this is just the beginning. Because we can't raise enough funding just for the earthquake, like you said. The tsunami is coming, and we need to shore up the resources to fight that battle. And really, the way I see it, a lot of organizations and leaders like you, Neelam, what you've done is you're really holding the line on these outcomes right now across health, across livelihoods, across education, that India has risks backsliding on, right? The development gains made over the last 10 years, you know, we run the risk of backsliding on them with, you know, what, with 230 million Indians moving back into poverty in the last year and a half due to COVID. I mean, that has massive ramifications across all of these sectors that we're talking about. And civil society has stepped up, and we as the funding community need to build the resilience of the nonprofit and civil society to continue to fight this fight, right, in a stronger manner. And I think that's really the call of the, you know, the need and the call to action that we are hoping to make with philanthropists and the community at large that we are engaging with. So that's a little bit of where what we've done, what we've seen. And in the last few minutes we have left, Neelam, I wanted to circle back, you know, to you and ask from your perspective, what more needs to be done now?
Yes, Vishal, I think the experience and seeing how some of ecosystem players like Dasra in India have worked, I think it's been very electrifying also for the rest of the ecosystem. That is also very important that you kind of set the trend. I'll be very frank. When COVID 2.0 hit, we are part of a large global collaborative called Catalyst 2030. And in India, we anchor a bunch of us organizations, Catalyst 2030 India. And it's also the apex body, the National Association of Social Entrepreneurs, right? So India has not only been badly hit by COVID, it's also been badly hit by a government which has been changing the foreign contribution regulatory authority laws. So a lot of the smaller on the ground NGOs haven't been able to access funding. Yeah. So we are in grave danger of civil society also at grassroots level having limited oxygen to survive. So it's just not been COVID, it's been a double whammy from many directions. And now I speak for the ecosystem, right? That as we have all shed our siloed thinking, we've all come together, right? And we formed our coalitions. We have the National Association of Social Entrepreneurs. It is really, really timely that we take this momentum forward, right? And seriously look at the SDG goals, right? COVID is many ways an eye-opener to climate change, which is around, it's there, it's around us, right? I mean, and therefore the SDG goals is something that addresses all the sort of problems the world and the planet is going to face. And through COVID, it's become clear what India faces, China faces, everyone is going to face. There is no problem which is an isolated problem anymore on the planet. It's a global problem. And therefore, it'll be fantastic if this momentum is carried forward and this symposium that we are part of, it makes people aware on what a, that there are trillions of dollars of shortfall in funding to meet the SDG goals, right? And it is so critical for philanthropy globally to step up to the plate and really look at how all of us together can really have the SDG goals met in time. I mean, 2030 is around the corner, and I don't think we have that much of time. Yeah, so that's what I wanted to share.
No, we don't. And thank you so much for those wonderful insights, Neelam. And thanks to everyone.
Sushant. Yeah, it's been a lovely conversation. It's been a real pleasure.